a technical note, which is this is published every year. Basically, everything stays the same. So if you compare this HDR technical note, this is released by UNDP, United Nations Development Program, and it stays the same every year with just slight changes. So as I just said that the HDI was introduced in 1990, and if you look at the broad changes, so we are in 2020 right now, and there has been some good amount of time that we have spent from the time when HDI was introduced. So there have been some changes from 1992 to till date, and we will be looking at some of these changes, how the index has been changed in on some aspects. So the basic representation of this index is that you have three dimensions. First one is health, so long and healthy life. Then the second dimension is knowledge, and the third dimension is a decent standard of living. These are the three dimensions which have stayed constant right from the inception of this index till date. So these three dimensions haven't really changed. They were as it is. The indicators have witnessed some changes from 1990 till date. So you will notice that for each of these dimensions, we construct a variable, we construct an indicator to measure this dimension. So long and healthy life is measured by an indicator called as life expectancy at birth. The second dimension is knowledge, which is measured by two indicators. So it's only knowledge that we use two indicators to measure this dimension. The rest of the two dimensions are measured by only one indicator. So long and healthy life is measured by life expectancy at birth. Please note that we are talking about life expectancy at birth. I will come to what do we mean by life expectancy at birth. Two indicators that we use for the knowledge dimension are expected years of schooling and mean years of schooling. And decent standard of living, we again use only one indicator for this dimension, which is gross national income per capita calculated in PPP dollars. So these are the four indicators that we use which go into the construction of this index, Human Development Index. I'm sure if you would have seen some reports, some article where you would have read about Human Development Index, you would have noted that this value is between 0 and 1. So the value of this index is between 0 and 1, but you know that these indicators may not be between 0 and 1. I mean, these could be, so if you are talking about life expectancy, it could be 60 years, it could be 75 years, and so on. Similarly, for years of schooling, you could have 15, 16, 18 years of schooling, and so on. So how do we bring these indicators into this format? Because we ultimately want our index to be in the range of 0 to 1. So the third step is to, so we move from dimensions to indicators. First is that we chose three dimensions because we want to capture a holistic view of development. So we take health, education, and income. And then we pick few indicators which are considered as a good proxy for these dimensions. So we take these four indicators and then to convert these indicators into an index format, we build dimension indices. So for life expectancy, we have life expectancy index. For education, we create an index called as education index. And then for decent standard of living, we calculate another index, which is called as the GNI index. So basically, for all these three dimensions, we ultimately create three different indices. And then we aggregate these three indices to finally get what we desire, which is the Human Development Index. So the broad overview of how HDI is calculated is, you pick three dimensions, health, education, and income. For each of these three dimensions, you pick indicators. life expectancy for health, expected years of schooling and mean years of schooling for knowledge, and decent standard of living, you use GNI per capita in terms of PPP dollars. Then for each of these dimensions, using these indicators, you calculate an index. And so you basically ultimately in the last stage, you have three indices. And then to get human development index, you aggregate them to get to the value of HDI. Now, how do we actually create an index? How do we create dimension specific index? And how do we reach HDI? How do we aggregate these three indices to reach HDI is where the entire technicality lies in, which will basically be our discussion for today's class. But before we reach that, you will also notice that in this technical note, you will notice that there are other kinds of HDI as well. Initially it was only this index which was introduced, but later on it was felt that we should have more variants of this index and to account for different aspects of development. So there is something called as inequality adjusted human development index, which takes into account the inequalities that you witness in the distribution of each of these indices. So you might have some inequality in life expectancy. You might have some distributional, the variance or the inequality in the distribution of these three indices. And hence, to account for that, you calculate an inequality adjusted human development index. Then you have something called as gender development index. This accounts for the bias that a particular gender might face. So you might have a country with a higher HDI value, but it might also be interesting to note that what is the HDI value for different genders in a society. So is it that the distribution of HDI is also varies across different genders? So that to account for that, you calculate gender development index. Then there is gender inequality index. There is multidimensional poverty index. These are a few variants of these development indices which are not part of your course, but just so that you know that there are these different indicators as well. It's important that you keep these in mind as well. But we are not going to cover these rest of the indicators in detail. What we are going to cover is the Human Development Index. So where first question is, where do you get the data from? So for all these indicators that we just looked at, we looked at life expectancy, expected years of schooling, mean years of schooling. Where do you actually get the data from? This is the list of data sources that you use to get the data on these different indicators. So life expectancy you get from this source, expected years of schooling from multiple sources, mean years of schooling again from multiple sources, GNI per capita from World Bank, IMF, UN Stats Division, etc. So these are the data sources from which you get the data for each of the countries that you use to calculate HDI. Next is, right in the first page, we saw that you have three indicators and then you calculate you have four indicators and then you calculate three indices for each of these indicators. So the next step is to create the dimension indices. So health, life expectancy index, education index and GNI index. So to create these indices, what you do is you first identify the minimum and maximum values for each of these indicators. These are also called as goalposts, and they are set in order to transform the indicators in the range of 0 to 1. They are also called as natural zeros or aspirational targets. So in this chart, in this table, you will notice that you have the dimensions, the three dimensions. Then you have the indicators for each of these three dimensions. And then you have here two columns, minimum and maximum. Jahan pe aapko ye pata lag raha hai that for what is the minimum value for life expectancy and what is the maximum value for life expectancy. Now, this is based on some historical evidences. So for life expectancy, you take the minimum value as 20 years, and this is based on some definitely an extensive amount of research, but on a long run historical evidence from papers by Madison and Riley, which have shown that a society or a subgroup of society which has a life expectancy below 20 years will fail to reproduce itself. So 20 year minimum life expectancy is expected in a society for it to survive. So for any society, for any economy to stay, to sustain, to survive, it is required that people at least live for 20 years. So that is the minimum goalpost that is set, and these are fixed values. They do not change for countries. So suppose you have 100 countries for which you are calculating the HDI, the minimum value for life expectancy indicator for each of these 100 countries will stay at 20. The maximum value will stay at 85. So you identify these minimum and maximum values and you keep them as fixed values for each of these countries. 20 years is taken as the minimum value for life expectancy and 85 years for the maximum value. Now again, identification of these are based on research, they are based on historical evidences, they are based on what is the maximum amount in the pool of countries that you have taken. So they are identified based on these different considerations. So 20 years, historically also it has been found that a society is expected to live for at least 20 years so that it can sustain, so that it can survive, because any society which fails to maintain their life expectancy below, I mean, they are not able to maintain 20 years of life expectancy, if the life expectancy is less than that, then the society will fail to reproduce itself and hence it won't be able to survive in the long run. Now, what exactly is life expectancy? I forgot about this. So, life expectancy is basically it is defined as the number of years a newborn infant could expect to live if prevailing patterns of age-specific mortality rates at the time of birth were to stay the same throughout the child's life. So please note, I'll just share this tab as well. So please note each and every word of this definition, and then only you will be clear with what do we mean by life expectancy. So it is the number of years a newborn infant, and that's why we use the term life expectancy at birth. So this is the number of years a newborn infant could expect to live if prevailing patterns of age-specific mortality rates at the time of birth were to stay the same throughout the child's life. Meaning that for each age category, you might have some patterns of mortality rates depending on health conditions, depending on age specific conditions, you might have certain mortality rates. So maybe at your infancy stage, you might have some mortality pattern because of health conditions, because of geographical conditions and so on. And as you grow older, the mortality pattern changes. So if that age specific mortality pattern stays the same, jo mortality pattern us time pe tha jis time pe us newborn baby ne birth liya hai, if the same pattern is followed throughout the child's life, then what is the average number of years that the child will live? That is life expectancy. Now life expectancy doesn't mean that you will stay those number of years, you will live for those number of years, because it is possible that these age specific mortality patterns might change as a child grows. So suppose a newborn child takes birth and it is expected that he or she will live for 60 years in a specific country. You have these life expectancy values different for different countries, obviously depending on the health conditions, depending on the geographical conditions, depending on a lot of other factors. You identify a life expectancy at birth value for each country. Now, it doesn't necessarily mean that the child will live for those many years, as I just said, because the calculation of these life expectancy number is based on the assumption that the pattern of age-specific mortality will stay the same, but that may not be true. It's possible that a child, when he or she grows, he might follow some kind of behavior that might change his life expectancy over his period of life. So we are taking this life expectancy, it is kind of an expectation. It is not the exact number of years that a child lives in a specific country. I hope that distinction is clear, because it is important to keep that in mind. Okay, coming back to this page. So you have for life expectancy, minimum value 20, maximum 85. Then for education, you have two indicators. Expected years of schooling, and they are calculated in number of years. The unit of measurement for life expectancy is years, and for these two indicators as well, the unit of measurement is years. So expected years of schooling and mean years of schooling. Again, what do we mean by these indicators? Let's all right. So mean years of schooling is basically measured for adults who are aged 25 years or older. So mean years of schooling is calculated for adults 25 years and older. Expected years of schooling is measured for children of school entering age. So two indicators for education. One, mean years of schooling is measured for people, for adults who are 25 year old or greater than that, older than that. Expected years of schooling is measured for children who are just entering school. So definitely, if someone is just entering school, you will calculate the expected number of years that person will stay in school, and that is why the term expected years of schooling. Mean years of schooling is the average number of years that a person has stayed in school once he has passed that stage. So for people who are 25 year and older than that, then we are calculating in this population of people who are 25 years old or older than 25 years, in this population we are calculating the average number of years of schooling, whereas for the expected years of schooling, the population is different. For expected years of schooling, we are only looking at children who are supposed to enter school. So again, this distinction has to be kept in mind when we look at these two indicators. So estimates for mean years of schooling are based on the duration of schooling at each level of education. Expected years of schooling are based on two factors. Expected years of schooling are again based on two factors. First is enrollment by age at all levels of education. So first is that how many people are registering themselves in a typical school. So enrollment by age at all levels of education. Then number of children. Second factor is number of children of school age in the population for each level of education. So number of children of school age, you're basically looking at children who are of that age, who are of the age which are supposed to go to school. So you're looking at children of school age in the population for each level of education, and how many children are enrolling themselves in a typical school for their age category. Again, it is important to note that the duration for each level of education may differ from country to country. Each level of education, we basically mean primary, upper primary, secondary, and so on. And that's why it's important to note that the duration for each level may differ from country to country, and this is taken into account when we calculate mean and expected years of schooling. So basically, it's possible that in India you require 12 years of schooling to complete from 1st to 12th grade. It's possible that in some other country you require 15 years. So you basically, the duration for a particular level of education might differ from one country to another country, and that has to be taken into consideration when you calculate expected years of schooling and mean years of schooling. Now, how do you do that calculation? How do you take that consideration into account is slightly complex, and we are not going to get into those details, but you should definitely remember this point, that this has to be taken into account, that this duration could differ from country to country, and hence that has to be taken into consideration when we calculate these two indicators. Again, the steps that we followed for life expectancy, which is to calculate the minimum and maximum, is done for these two indicators as well. So for both the indicators, you would notice that the minimum value is kept at zero. The minimum value is kept at zero because it's believed that any society can live without formal education. That society may not be a developed society, but it's not like life expectancy. So we said if we would have kept life expectancy at zero, then the society wouldn't have been able to survive. That was the historical evidence, that below 20 years, if a society has life expectancy below 20 years, then the society would not sustain. But the same doesn't hold true for schooling. If a society, if children in a particular society do not go to school at all, technically the society can physically survive. They may not be a developed society. It might be a huge amount of chaos in the society, but the society can physically survive. So we are picking on 0 years of schooling as the minimum value for both the indicators. Expected years of schooling is taken at 18. And mean years of schooling is kept at 15. So again, this is based on values from different countries, based on historical evidences, and hence these 18 and 15, the values of expected and mean years, are kept at these levels. Right. Then next is standard of living, which is measured by gross national income per capita. The minimum value, this indicator doesn't need explanation. We've already talked about PPP dollars in the last unit, in the last chapter. So I don't think we would discuss this. I am sure you are all clear with this indicator. The minimum value is kept at 100. And the maximum is kept at $75,000. These are PPP dollars. So 100 is kept as the minimum value, again based on historical evidences and observed values, based on country patterns, different countries, what are the values of GNI per capita for each of these countries, and from these observations you calculate the minimum and maximum values. And minimum is kept at $100 because that is the minimum subsistence. This takes into consideration that considerable amount of unmeasured subsistence and non-market production in economies close to the minimum. So economies which are towards the lower end of the economic growth chart, these economies have fair bit of unmeasured subsistence and non-market production, because these economies do produce, they do not always produce for the market, sometimes they produce for themselves, and that doesn't go into the actual figures. So there is definitely some kind of measurement issues, and to take that into account, you pick up such a low value of $100 for GNI indicator. And you use the natural log values of GNI instead of the absolute values. so that there are lesser outliers and there is lesser variance in your distribution, because you will face a lot of variation in these values of GNI. So to avoid that, you use the log values. And 75,000 is again picked up from evidences that virtually no gain in human development and well-being can be attained from annual income above 75,000. So it has been seen. We know that the marginal utility from income decreases as income increases. So beyond a certain point, I mean, you will obviously see that when income increases, the marginal utility will also increase. But beyond a certain point, there is virtually no extra utility that you can derive from the extra money. So that is, this value has been observed as that benchmark value, that beyond $75,000 GNI per capita, $75,000, beyond this value you do not see any gain in development. So that is kept as the kept at the maximum value. And even obviously the authorities, the people who are into the calculation of HDI will definitely make a lot of projections, and they see that assuming an annual growth rate of 5%, only 3 countries were projected to exceed this ceiling in the next 5 years, at which point the income index will be capped at 1. So out of the set of countries for which the HDI was calculated, it was only 3 countries who were projected to exceed this ceiling, this benchmark value, which is kept as the maximum value for the HDI calculation. Right. So these are the minimum and maximum values that we take for each of these indicators, and they are kept fixed for all countries. Now, once you identify these minimum and maximum values, you convert the indicators into their index, and you use this formula here. So you know the minimum value for each of the indicators, you know the maximum value. These three variables are known to us. This is the variable, sorry, these are fixed values, these are not really variables. This is a variable here, which is the actual value. So for each country, suppose you're calculating the HDI for India, then you take for each index. So you will for each indicator, you will calculate the index and you will substitute the actual value of that indicator. So for example, life expectancy, if I have to calculate the dimension index for life expectancy, then I will take the actual value of life expectancy for the Indian economy. I will put it here. I will put the minimum value here, which is 20. Then I will put the maximum value, which is 75, I think. Let me just check. Sorry, 85, yeah. So you put the maximum value here, which is 85, and then minimum value 20. So for each country, the only thing that's changing in this formula is the actual value. The rest stays the same. So for each country, you will calculate the dimension index for each indicator. So we have 4 indicators: life expectancy at birth, mean years of schooling, expected years of schooling, and GNI per capita. You calculate the index for each of these indicators. So ultimately, what will you get? You will get these 4 indicators in the range of 0 to 1, and this is the formula that you use to convert the indicator values in this range. For education dimension, so we have already noted that for the 3 dimension, it is only the education dimension that we are using 2 indicators to account for education dimension. So for the education dimension, you calculate the index for expected years of schooling, then you calculate the index for mean years of schooling, and then to ultimately calculate the education index, you take the average of this, which is the arithmetic mean. So you take the arithmetic mean of these 2 index and ultimately get the education index. For the rest of the two indicators, it is very simple because you are only measuring them through one indicator. But for education dimension, since you are using two indicators, so first is to convert these indicators into index. So you will have the expected years of schooling in this range, 0 to 1. You will also have mean years of schooling in this range, 0 to 1. And then you will just take their arithmetic mean and calculate the education index. Right? Is 2. So now we've reached the stage where we have three indices now. One for each dimension. One for health, one for education, and one for standard of living. Then the final step is to aggregate these three indices. And the way with which you aggregate these three indices is by using geometric mean. So we have I health here, I education, I income. These I values are basically all three of them are between 0 and 1. Then for each of these three values, you take the product of them and you take the cube root of them. So you take the geometric mean of the three-dimensional indices, and the resultant number will tell you the overall HDI value. Right? Now, I would want to discuss this slightly in detail, that why do we take geometric mean here? Why don't we consider the arithmetic mean or any other kind of aggregation? Why is it that we are only using the geometric mean to calculate the HDI here? But before we do that, let's first quickly look at a mathematical example here, so that we are clear with how to actually calculate this for each country, and then we'll discuss why do we take geometric mean here. Alright, so we are given an example here where data for Bangladesh is given. So for Bangladesh, for each of the four indicators, you are given the value. So life expectancy is 72.3, expected years of schooling is 11.2, mean years of schooling is 6.1. Notice how starkly different these two values are. Actual years of schooling, which is measured for population who's 25 years old or greater than that, it's only 6.1 year that you observe, which is on an average people stay in school for 6.1 years, and expected is 11.2 years, which is quite different. Then gross national income, you have this value. You are given the four indicator values. You have to calculate the HDI value for Bangladesh. So how do you do that? You first calculate the four index. For each of these indicators, you convert them in 0 to 1 range. So for life expectancy, which is the health index, you take the actual value, which is 72.3, minimum value 20 divided by maximum minus minimum. You notice that the final index value is between 0 and 1. The same thing is done for expected years of schooling, actual value minus minimum value divided by maximum minus minimum between 0 and 1. Mean years of schooling, again you do the same thing. Then you notice that since we want only one index for each dimension, we take the average of these two, and by average we are taking the arithmetic mean. So we take the arithmetic mean of these two indices here, and we get the final education index. This is the final education index that goes into the calculation of the HDI. Then you do the same thing for income. Notice that for income we are taking the log. So we take the log of this value, then we take the log of minimum value, log of maximum value, and subtract it with log of minimum value, and we get the final index for income. The final stage is to aggregate these three measures, three indices: health index, education index, and income index. So to do that, we take the geometric mean here. So we take the product of these three index values and take the cube root of the product. So the final value is the human development index, which is 0.614. we aggregate the three indices by taking the geometric mean. We could have taken arithmetic mean as well, but why we don't go for arithmetic mean is important to understand. So let's look at the calculations here. Also note that for education index, right now currently we are using two components, which are expected years of schooling and mean years of schooling. But previously, before 2010, we were using adult literacy rate and school attendance rate. And right now, what we do is we take the arithmetic mean of the two components, of the two indicators. But previously, before 2010, we were using these two measures, adult literacy rate and school attendance, and they were measured, they were weighted. We used to take a weighted arithmetic mean instead of a normal equally weighted arithmetic mean. We placed different weights previously. So adult literacy was placed at 1 by 3 and school attendance was weighted at 2 by 3. But this was the methodology which was adopted before 2010. After 2010, we have two indicators which are different from these two. We have mean years and expected years, and these two components have been equally weighted since 2010. So you, if you're interested, you can go through this section to understand why we have moved from adult literacy and school attendance to the measures that we are using. All right, moving ahead to the measurement part. Right. Okay. So basically, when we talk about geometric mean, geometric mean is basically a special case of the family of general means. And the attribute it averages can be income or any other cardinal measure. What do we mean by if we talk about a particular attribute x here, we are basically a distribution would look something like this. So if a distribution has n people, if it has n people, then x1, x2, xn will be your distribution. So if this is an attribute that you are calculating the mean for, then the distribution would look something like this. In our case, x is the it could be life expectancy, it could be any other indicator. So basically, we are looking at the distribution of these indicators. Now, the general mean. Now, notice that this general mean is not the same as arithmetic mean. Arithmetic mean or geometric mean are part of general mean. General mean is defined as this. This is the definition of general mean, and geometric mean, arithmetic mean, these are all special cases of general mean. This is how general mean is defined. So general mean is defined as for this distribution, if you have to calculate the general mean, then this is how the mean will be calculated for alpha value not equal to 0. And for alpha value equal to 0, the general mean is defined as this. So basically, this is the formula for geometric mean. This is how we calculate geometric mean. It is the nth root of the product of n observations. So since in HDI we have three observations, we take the cube root of the product of the three indices. This is what we use for HDI calculation, and this is a special case of general mean when the alpha is equal to 0. What do we mean by alpha now? Look at this box here. So when alpha is equal to 1, general mean becomes arithmetic mean. So if you substitute alpha here to be equal to 1, then you will get x1 plus x2 plus xn divided by n, which is nothing but the arithmetic mean. So alpha is equal to 1 gives you a special case of general mean, which is called as the arithmetic mean. Alpha is equal to 0 gives you a special case of the general mean, which is called as the geometric mean. The other two cases could be where alpha is greater than 1 or alpha is less than 1. Now, when alpha is greater than 1, what does it represent? It basically represents a scenario where you are giving more weight to higher values of x. So, when alpha is greater than 1, it's obvious that you are placing more weight on values which have greater values. So, for higher values, you are placing more weight. When alpha is less than 1, then you are placing more weight on lower values of x. So, basically, we use these this alpha greater than 1 or alpha less than 1 basically accounts for the inequality that you might have in your data, but it might actually accentuate the inequality in your data set. Because if suppose alpha is less than 1, then what you're doing is the general mean is placing more weight. When alpha is less than 1, then the general mean is placing more weight on its elements with lower values, which in effect is actually in the measurement, you are basically widening the already existing inequality. You are exaggerating the already existing inequality by using alpha less than 1. So if suppose a particular x value is already less, then by taking alpha to be less than 1, you are placing more weight on that x value, which is that the already existing variance, the already existing inequality between x1, x2 and xn has been further increased if you take alpha less than 1. When there would be no inequality, suppose there is no inequality in the distribution, there is no inequality in this x1, x2, xn distribution, then it is possible that the general mean with any alpha not equal to 1, which is alpha greater than 1 or alpha less than 1, then in that case it will coincide with the arithmetic mean. But when the elements are unequally distributed, when there is variance in this distribution, then the general mean will differ. Then the general mean with alpha less than 1 will be lower than the arithmetic mean. So basically in arithmetic mean, what do? You place equal weights to each of these x1, x2, xn values. When you calculate arithmetic mean, you don't weigh each of these elements differently. You place equal weights. So if there is some kind of inequality in your data set, and suppose you use a general mean where alpha is less than 1 or alpha is greater than 1, then definitely the answer would be biased, because you are sort of widening the already existing gaps. So when alpha is less than 1 and there is inequality in your data set, then your general mean value will be less than the arithmetic mean value. When alpha is greater than 1, then and there is inequality in your data set, then your answer will be greater than the arithmetic mean, because arithmetic mean doesn't really account for any kind of inequality. Arithmetic mean will simply place equal weights to each of the values in your data set. It wouldn't weigh a particular value differently than the other value. And that is the reason why we really don't use arithmetic mean for calculation of HTI. It will become more clear as we proceed to actual examples and look at the calculation there. We'll just look at these examples then. Alright, so suppose you have here three distributions. Distribution A, distribution B and distribution C, and you notice that there are three values here. So imagine these values to be the indices that we have just looked at. So maybe this one is health index, this health index, this is education, this is gross national income, and you have three distributions A, B and C. At the first sight, you notice that this distribution is equal. It is equally distributed, meaning that all the three values are the same. the life expectancy value is also 0.5, health is also 0.5, and national income, gross national income, is also 0.5. But if you look at distribution A, you will notice that there is inequality in the distribution. So 0.1, which is towards the lower end of the range. Then you have 0.9, which is towards the higher end. So these are actually the two extremes. And then you have a middle point here. So you see, if you compare these three values here, you notice that the three indices are highly unequal. If you look at distribution B, again, you notice that this is unequal, but this inequality is lesser than distribution A. So if I had to rank these three distributions in terms of equality amongst the three indicators, then I will say C has the highest equality, then B, and then A. So A is the highest, has the greatest inequalities amongst the three distributions, then B and then C, right? Now, if suppose I take arithmetic mean of these three distributions, what values would I get? As I just said, that the arithmetic mean doesn't place different weights to these different values. It will consider 0.1 as equivalent to 0.9 if you take the arithmetic mean. So if you take the arithmetic mean for these three distributions, it will all, for all these cases, you will get the same answer. So 0.1 plus 0.5 plus 0.9 divided by 3 will give you 0.5. This will also give you 0.5, and what's the third one? That will also give you 0.5. So you notice that when you take arithmetic mean for these three distributions, the answer is the same, and the reason is that the arithmetic mean doesn't place different weights to different observations. It considers there is no consideration of inequality across this distribution here. So suppose I look at, suppose these are three different countries, and I basically want to understand the HDI values for these three countries, I will get the same HDI values for these three countries. But if I actually look at, I dwell deeper into the calculation of the HDI value, I will get some different interpretations here, because this country seems to be doing better than this country in terms of income, right? So this is 0.5 and this is 0.9, whereas it is doing very bad in terms of health. It is, this distribution C is 0.5, whereas distribution A is 0.1. So by taking the HDI as 0.5 for both these distributions, I am in a way trying to say that that any kind of degradation in terms of the health index is quite well substituted by improvement in the income index. So if I just take, if I place both these distributions at 0.5, in a way I am saying that, all right, that distribution A is better in terms of income, but is worse off in terms of health. But even then, even despite these differences, I am treating them as equal in terms of HDI. I consider them as equally developed, equally human developed nations. Why? The reason being that I am saying that improvements in income are perfectly substitutable for any kind of degradation in terms of health. But that is not really true. That is the whole idea we have been discussing so far, that if income is greater in a country, that doesn't really mean that it can substitute for any kind of adversities the country faces in terms of health or education. That is the whole point that we have been propagating so far. So that is the reason why we really can't take arithmetic mean, because that will sort of hide a lot of discrepancies that we might see across these three indices, which is reflected when we take the geometric mean. So we'll just look at geometric mean here. So for these three distributions, if I now calculate the geometric mean, then these are the values that I get. So for distribution A, I get 0.36. For distribution B, I get 0.44. And for distribution C, I get 0.5. Now you notice that distribution A has the least HDI value, whereas distribution, so the ranking will be A has the least HDI value, then B, and then C, which gives you now a clearer picture of the kind of situation these three distributions are in, right? So this is primarily the reason why we wouldn't want to take arithmetic mean when we are calculating HDI, and we would want to use geometric mean, because geometric mean sort of gives you a more accurate picture of the scenario in terms of the three indices here. So because it accounts for the inequality here between the health index and the income index, it gives you a smaller value than 0.5. This one is more equally distributed and hence it gives you 0.5. This one is not exactly equally distributed but is better than distribution A, and that's why you get a value which is greater than distribution A but less than distribution C. Now you will get these values different for each alpha values. If you look at the general mean formula, if you remember the formula, if suppose alpha was equal to minus 1, which is alpha less than 1, this is the case where alpha is equal to 0, right? Then your values will even be lower. Then the value that we get for A here will even be lower if I put alpha to be less than 1. But it will be equal to what we get for distribution C here, because it is equally distributed. Remember that we just spoke about the general mean for a particular distribution to be lesser than the arithmetic mean when there is inequality in the data set. So when alpha is less than 1, then the general mean in this case for any distribution would be less than the arithmetic mean only when the distribution has some inequality. If the distribution is not doesn't have any aspect of inequality, then the general mean in this case and the general mean in the case when you are taking arithmetic mean, which is alpha is equal to 1, you will get the same answers. So when you have alpha less than 1 and if you calculate the general mean for each of these distributions, you will notice that for distribution C the answers will stay the same, but for distribution A and distribution B you will get less than arithmetic, you'll get the values less than the arithmetic mean. Right. Now, in this graph, they have for each alpha value, they have calculated the general means. So alpha is equal to 0, alpha greater than 0, alpha is equal to 1, or alpha less than 1. They have represented all kinds of alpha values and they have shown the graphs here. B and C are basically the three distributions. Yeah, these A, B, C are basically three distributions that we just saw here, and they have calculated the general means for each of these alpha values here. The way you interpret this graph is that these three are the three distributions that we have been talking, that we've taken as an example here, and on the x-axis you have the alpha values, and they've calculated for each of these alpha values, they've calculated the general means, and you will notice that that for distribution C, which is perfectly equal irrespective of what alpha value you put in the formula of general mean, the answer is same, which is 0.5, which is what we saw, what we discussed when we were talking about general means, that when there is no inequality, then even when alpha is less than 1, the general mean will give you the same answer as that of arithmetic mean, which is what you see here. So for distribution C, you notice that irrespective of the alpha value, irrespective of what general mean, which category of general mean you are using, you will always get the same answer, which is 0.5. For distribution A, which is the largest unequal society or distribution, you notice that the general mean value increases as the alpha value increases. And for alpha is equal to 0, which is the case of geometric mean, you get this value, right? Alpha, remember, alpha is equal to 0 is the case of geometric mean, whereas alpha is equal to 1 is the case of arithmetic mean. So this is the case of arithmetic mean. So for distribution A, if you are calculating the arithmetic mean, this is the answer, which is colliding with distribution C, which is the same as distribution C. And if you are calculating geometric mean, the answer is less than 0.5, which is what we saw, which is what we saw mathematically as well. Distribution B as well, you notice that when you calculate the geometric mean, which is when alpha is equal to 0, this is the answer that you get. This is the general mean that you get. And if you calculate it at alpha is equal to 1, it again clashes with 0.5. For alpha less than 1, you notice that the difference is even larger, right? For geometric mean, the difference is lesser. If you look at arithmetic mean value and you look at geometric mean value, this is the difference that you notice. This is the difference for distribution B, and for distribution A, this is the difference. But if you take alpha less than 1, then you will notice the difference is even larger. Suppose I take alpha is equal to minus 1, then this is the value that I get for distribution B. This is the answer that I get for C, and this is the answer that I get for A. So basically, the difference increases, the gap increases. Because now when alpha is less than 1, then you are accentuating, you are exaggerating the inequalities. You are placing larger weights on the lower values. And that's why you see that distribution A value drops even further. Geometric mean mein answer aa raha tha 0.36. Jab aap alpha less than 1 loge, to answer usse bhi zyada kam aayega. Kyunki ab aap 0.1, jo sabse choti value thi index ki, डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन ए के लिए, आप उसमें और ज़्यादा वेट प्लेस कर रहे हो. तो जैसे जैसे आप डिक्रीज करते जाओगे अल्फा की वैल्यू, वैसे वैसे ये गैप बढ़ता जाएगा, विच इज़ अगेन ऑल्सो नॉट जस्टिफाइड, बिकॉज यू आर नॉट शोइंग द एक्यूरेट पिक्चर, यू आर नॉट शोइंग द एक्यूरेट रिप्रेजेंटेशन ऑफ द इनइक्वालिटी, विच इज़ वेल रिफ्लेक्टेड इन दिस केस, which is the case of geometric mean, and that justifies why we use geometric mean when we calculate the HDI values. Alright, so I'll just read out this paragraph and I think it will become clearer whatever we have discussed so far. So this example clearly shows you the rationale for using the geometric mean instead of arithmetic mean for HDI calculations. The geometric mean penalizes inequality in achievements across dimensions. In fact, the three distributions can also be seen as a dimension indices of the HDI, which we have already seen. If there are higher inequalities between achievements in income as compared to achievements in health and education, this will yield a lower HDI than relative to a case where you have the same average achievement, which is what we saw when we took the geometric mean for distributions A and C. So C, for each index you have the same value, 0.5. For A you had different values, and that's why when we took the geometric mean, we saw that the HDI for A is lesser than the HDI for C. Note that the geometric mean will also penalize countries that have high achievements in terms of health and education if they have relatively low income. So it is not just the case that you are penalizing one index over the other. It is not that you have something against index, against income index. You will, because it is a mathematical construct, it doesn't know, I mean, there is no social input given to the index that it's only when the income index is lesser you want to place more weight. It will be the case even when you notice that there are high achievements in health and education but relatively low achievements in income. So for countries which are less developed, but are less developed in the sense of income, which are economically weaker societies, but if they have better health and education scenario, even then the HDI will be lesser because you have relatively low income index. So any kind of inequality across these three indices will be captured when we take geometric mean as the mathematical background for the calculation of HDI, which will be hidden if you take arithmetic mean. Also, another important reason why you would be interested in taking geometric mean is to compare countries over a period of time. If you look at the trend of the HDI for a specific country, even then it seems more reasonable to use geometric mean, because the arithmetic mean treats the three dimensions as perfect substitutes. As I just I showed you from A to C, that any kind of adversities that distribution A faces in terms of health, which was 0.1 as compared to 0.5 for distribution C, was well substituted by improvements in the income index, which was 0.9, and for distribution C it was 0.5. So arithmetic mean wouldn't capture, arithmetic mean would say that okay, the health index is 0.4 units lesser for distribution A, but the income is 0.5 units greater, and the arithmetic mean would treat these differences as equal, as perfectly substitutable. That is, it assumes a decrease in one component can be compensated by an equal increase in another to yield the same level of overall achievement. This is important when you are comparing achievement across different periods of time. Consider distribution A and C above, and imagine a country moved from distribution A to distribution C. Suppose these were same countries but mapped in different time periods. Right now we were analyzing these distributions as different countries, but for a time, for just a little moment, imagine that country distribution A and distribution C represent the same country but in two different time periods. So suppose distribution A is time period 2000 and distribution C is time period 2020. Now when you notice that the same country has moved from distribution A to C, you notice that there has been improvements in terms of health, because you will notice that from distribution A to distribution C there has been increase in the health index, but there has been a decrease in the income index. But if suppose you had to take arithmetic mean, if arithmetic mean was used to assess the overall achievement, then this would not reflect any change in the overall HDI. And the conclusion that you would end up making would be that the countries are at the same platform. But that's not really the picture. That's not really the scenario. If, however, you were using geometric mean, then you would see that the country has seen an overall improvement, because you notice, if you remember, then distribution A HDI was 0.36 and distribution C's value was 0.5. So if you took geometric mean and if you compared this country over a specific time period, you would notice that this country has witnessed an improvement. It has, the value has increased from 0.3 to 0.5, which will not be reflected in the arithmetic measure that you would have taken. If you would have taken that, it would have hidden this improvement. So it's also relevant to use geometric mean when we are comparing trends for the same set of countries. It is not just important and relevant for a cross-sectional analysis, but also for a time series analysis where you are comparing a particular country over a specific time period. So the geometric mean rewards overall balance. That is, the geometric mean requires a larger improvement in one element to compensate for a loss in another element. Thus, if we need to retain the level of overall achievement unchanged at say 0.5, then compensating for a 0.4 units loss in the first element would require more than 4 units of improvement in the another dimension. So basically, we are saying that arithmetic mean captures the changes as perfectly substitutable. Changes in different indices are treated as perfectly substitutable, whereas in case of geometric mean, it is not the case. 0.4 units decrease in the health index is not equivalent to 0.4 units increase in the income index. You would need more than 0.4 units increase in the income index to maintain the same level of HDI, which is 0.5. And you can conduct this activity by yourself by picking out different numbers and calculate the geometric and arithmetic mean for different distributions, and you will understand each and every word of what this statement is trying to explain. So basically, we are just saying that suppose we had to keep distribution A and C at the same level. If distribution C is 0.5, and by taking geometric mean, if I had to keep this as well at 0.5, then what is the change in the three indicators that I would require? It would be, so this was 0.1 for distribution A. Let's just go back to that one. Right, for distribution A, you had 0.1 and 0.9. And you get 0.36 here and you get 0.5 here. Suppose I had to maintain 0.5 here, but the mathematical construct was geometric mean, then you would notice that I would need a larger change here in this value than just 0.9. Or I would need some kind of improvement here or some kind of improvement here. So whereas in case of arithmetic mean, you can maintain this at 0.5. just by making sure the differences in each of these respective indices are same. So if this is less than this value by 0.4, then if this is greater than this value by 0.4, you can keep this at 0.5. But the same cannot be maintained when you are taking the geometric mean here. So that is the whole idea, that geometric mean doesn't consider the indices to be perfectly substitutable to each other. All right, one last thing that we are left with is the categories. So based on the HDI values that you get for different countries, you put these countries into different categories, which is represented here in this table. So a country whose HDI value is 0.8 or more than that, between 0.8 and 1, the maximum HDI value can be 1, the minimum value can be 0. So any country which has its HDI value between 0.8 and 1 will be placed in this category, which is very high human development. Then 0.7 to 0.799 will be kept in this category, high human development. 0.55 to 0.699 will be kept in medium human development. And below 0.55 will be kept in low human development. So these are the four categories that you finally use to identify the level of development in a particular nation. Based on the HDI value, you categorize these countries as either of the four placed here. So suppose you had to place Bangladesh here, which whose HDI value was calculated to be 0.614, it will fall here in this category, which is medium human development.